This is the Lafayette Historical Society Oral History Project. Today is March 7, 2014. We are interviewing Bob Bru. And would you spell your name, Mr. Bru?
B-O-B. Bru, B-R-U.
Thank you. Why don't we start off with the beginning? Were you born in Lafayette?
No, I was born in London, England.
You were?
Yeah. My parents were American citizens, and they were living in London. My dad was in business. He traveled all over Europe representing the movies that were made by Douglas Fairbanks, and Charlie Chaplin, Wallace Beery.
Lon Chaney?
No, I never heard Lon Chaney mentioned. And Mary Pickford. Mm-hmm. And my uncle was partners with a guy by the name of William Fox. And they were like literary agents, they were movie agents. They marketed the films that I think was United Artists at the time made. And my dad's territory was Europe. And he spoke about four different languages. And marketed the films, the Hollywood films in Europe, which in the 20s were a hot item. That's why my parents lived there, which is why I happened to be born there. Okay. And when I was 9 years old, my family moved back to the United States. And I lived on Long Island from 1929 to 1932. Then I lived in Manhattan, went to school in Manhattan, grew up, and went to work when I was 18 in New York for a paper company. And then in 41, I saw too many movies with Errol Flynn and people like that in it, so I volunteered for the Army Air Corps. And I became what was called then an aviation cadet. And I trained to fly. And I ended up being a navigator on a B-17. And I flew to Europe. I flew to England. And I flew bombing missions over Germany out of England. And in July of 43, I was shot down, and I was a prisoner, a German prisoner, POW, for 2 years until the end of the war. And I was in Starred Look 3, which is the camp, if you saw the movie with Steve McQueen, The Great Escape, that was made, about that. My camp. And so then after I was liberated, I came back to New York. And during the war, while I was training, I was flying out of Walla Walla, Washington, Boise, Idaho, and so on. And I liked the West. And I felt New York was kind of dirty.
So, and cold.
So, I got married and drove out to the coast. And I had family in L.A. I visited there. I wasn't that happy with L.A. So, I drove up to San Francisco. And I had relatives in San Francisco. I visited there. I didn't like it. It was all foggy all the time. Mm-hmm. So I ended up at Berkeley, rented an apartment in And that, like on a Sunday drive, I'd drive through the tunnel, and here was this beautiful country out here, all warm and sunshine. And I said, boy, this is what I came to California for. So after a year of trying to be a traveling salesman, and I made up my mind, I want to be in business for myself. So that's when I opened my first store in Lafayette.
What years?
Well, that was, the store opened in January of 47, but I spent half of 46 putting the thing together. And, now in Lafayette, right in the middle of Lafayette, is it still Bank of the West, I think, that's there now?
At the corner, it's been there, yes, been 30, 40 years, yes.
Yeah, with my bank. Kind of diagonally across from it, there's a brick building, or like a chalet type of architecture.
Yes, still there.
Yeah, well, that was owned by a guy by the name of Paul Fix, who I imagine you probably don't have any records of. To me, he was a real nice guy, and his wife was a wonderful woman. And he was a baker, and he was of German ancestry. Mm-hmm. And because he was German, most of the good people of Lafayette didn't like him. He was a baker. I don't know if I told you that.
It was right after
was
the
it
war.
The, because called the yeah. Mayflower Bakery?
It was called the Mayflower Bakery.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
I've heard of it.
He had a fleet of trucks. In fact, I think he went as far as Pittsburgh with the trucks. And what the good people of Lafayette at that time didn't know was that they had two dogs, German shepherds. They really were very fond of them. And during the war, he had loaned them to the army, to the canine corps. Mm-hmm. So he was a pretty patriotic guy, is what I'm trying to say.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so I talked to him about opening his, I wanted to open a store. And he says, I got a piece of property that would be just right for you. Because I'm 26 years old. I don't know a hell of a lot about business, you know. So he drove me down on Golden Gate Way past the Park Theater, down where the Pioneer Food Market was, Vince Lombardo, right across the street from it. It was a piece of property. It was 22 feet wide and ran from Golden Gate Way all the way back to the creek. Well, what I didn't know was that the property had been owned by M.H. Stanley.
School. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Fran, the daughter.
Yeah. He lived on Moraga Boulevard, which is behind Golden Gate Way. And he owned all the property on that street. From the Park Theater pretty well down to the next street across the bridge. And he had given this 22-foot strip to his son. His son wanted to build base-like blocks on it. So like a lot of young sons, he did it for a while and then he quit. So the property was vacant. But Stanley had evidently turned around. He told his son when he either gave him or sold him the property with the proviso that if he didn't use it, he would give it back to his father. Mm-hmm. But the son didn't do that. I guess maybe he needed money. So he sold it to Paul Fix. Oh. His 22-foot strip. And that's what Paul Fix was talking to me about. Well, I didn't know any of this. Okay. Well, make a long story short, I bought this 22-foot piece of property, and Paul Fix had a little building up on Mount Diablo Boulevard, and there was another little building on the 22-foot property. So what I did is I took the two little buildings, had a contractor, his name was Cowley. I think it was J.K. Cowley, big, hefty guy. And he put the two buildings together on the property. And that's where I opened my store. And old man Stanley, he came down the street, and when the contractor was putting the buildings together, he told him, he says, the corner of that building's on my property. You know, he made a real fuss about it. So I got Leo Coleman. He was a surveyor. And he came over and he surveyed it. And he said, nope, he says, the buildings are safely on your 22 feet. Mm-hmm. So that's where I opened my first store. Well, I like books, as you can tell. And so I opened a store as a bookstore. It's called The Bookworm.
Oh, yeah.
And the first day we were open, we took in 72 cents. And it was also like a little rental library. And I remember telling my wife, I said, well, we can't get any worse than this. And the next day, I think it was something like 62 cents. So I quickly realized that we were going to be starving. I didn't do something about it. Well, I got this letter from my father-in-law who lived in New York, and he enclosed a copy of an ad for Macy's, full-page ad. I guess in the New York Times, advertising this new deal, which is called a ballpoint pen, a BB ballpoint pen. And he said, Nate, Macy's had placed an originating order for 6,000 of them. And he thought that would be a good thing for me to sell in the store. So I had to check around and find out who wholesaled the BB ballpoint pen in this area. So it turned out to be the William Barron Candy Company in Oakland. And so I called them up. I ordered a dozen BB pens. They're selling for 98 cents. And the sales tax at that time was 2%. So it was 98 cents, 2 cents. So it sold for a dollar. So here I am, the guy comes out in a truck, you know, on his regular route, delivers the pens to my store. I pay him for 60 cents each, you know, less 40%. And there I am with these 12 pens. Well, now what'll I do? So I figured, well, I'll go out and try to sell them. Because that's what I did in New York before the war for the paper company. I was a salesman. So I walk from my store, which is on Golden Gate Way, and I go up, and at that time Lafayette was just two business blocks. And I went up there, and I remember I went into the barber shop, and I don't know, within 20 minutes maybe, I came back to this store with 12 $1 bills. I sold all the pens. I go, boy, it's pretty good.
Hotcakes.
So I called up the Billy Barron Candy Company, you know, and I ordered two dozen. So it went. Well, a salesman came in. I was selling books, and I was selling greeting cards. I got the greeting card racks secondhand from some guy in Oakland that wanted to throw them out, and they were terrible racks. He put the cards in them and it slid down to the floor. though, because it was just a slanted plywood with glass going. So he came in, he says, you know, he says, you, this was a salesman from Duncan Vale, from Art Supply. He wanted me to put in art supplies. And he says, you're going to start here selling, trying to sell books. There's no foot traffic out there. People don't come by. So he talked about office supplies. He says there was a stationer here in Lafayette, but the guy left. And the last thing he said was that Lafayette would never support a stationery store. So I called up Schwabacher Fry in San Francisco, to big wholesale and retail store on Market Street. And I ordered some office supplies. I sent them out with a salesman. And I didn't know one thing from another, you know. So anyway, we unpacked it, put it on the shelves. And I went out. Of course, I've been selling the pens. I went out and started to call on all the business people in Lafayette to sell them office supplies. And they'd order something, and I'd have to say, what is it? And I didn't know. So they'd show me or explain to me what it was. Of course, at that time, they were buying in Oakland, you know, Smith Brothers. Big stationer in Oakland. And so bit by bit, you know, I learned the business. And I started calling on Rinder. Rinder Country Club was a good customer of mine. Clark Matthews was the name of the manager at the Rinder Country Club at that time. And Maisie O'Hara was a gal that ran the office. I called on Ben, can't remember his last name now, had the Willows restaurant in Arinda. Mm-hmm. And Ben Randall was the manager of the Arinda Theater, which had just opened actually a couple of years before. I called on Warden Travel Agency, Boise and Soule. I mentioned a million of them, you know. So I got to know all these people. Walnut Creek was my competitor. It was a guy by the name of Dahlgren that opened a stationery store on Main Street in Walnut Creek. And but I called on customers in Walnut Creek, and I called on a lot of customers in Concord. At that time, of course, these towns were all small. So Realtors, there were, you know, quite a few Realtors. Quite a few automobile dealers, some doctors. These were mostly the type of business people that were out here. So I got to know all of them. And so if you want to ask me any questions about them, I don't know what you want me to say. But one day I was in Walnut Creek, and, you know, there was no new building going on at that time because everything had, you know, been diverted to the war effort. So you couldn't find empty buildings or things. One day I was in Walnut Creek making a delivery. There was a store in Lafayette called the Emporium, it was called. And they sold suits and stuff. The guy's name was Dale Simpson, was the owner. There's something a little wrong about him. He kind of lived in a funny world, you know, inside him.
A little eccentric? A little eccentric?
Eccentric, yeah. He'd tell you things that weren't real, you know, that kind of stuff.
Entertaining.
So anyway, he stole the store. He got his income from his family who owned some big real estate stuff up in Vallejo. That's how he got his income, because he never made it in his business. But anyway, he sold the business in Lafayette, and he moved on Main Street in Walnut Creek and opened a store there. And so I was down there. I think I was making a delivery to his store. And I look across the street in this, what had been a pool hall on Main Street, Warren Creek. There was a little sign that said, store for rent. And I said, wow, look at that. So I went next door, and the building had been kind of subdivided. Next door was a shoe repair store. And this old guy from Arkansas, and he was working that with two of his sons. And I asked about the sign next door. And he said, oh, yeah, that was his sign. He's got it for rent. So I went into it, and it had been a pool hall. And no, nothing in it but the lights hanging down, you know, that had been over the tables, sawdust on the floor. And it was very, very unattractive.
A lot of work.
Yeah. So the store was wide in the back, because his repair shop only went back a little way, but very narrow in the front. So he had the front door and the little window. So I said, how much do you want, you know, to rent it? If I remember it correctly, it was $100 a month to rent. So I said, well, let's have a lease and sign it. He didn't want any lease. No, my word. So we shook hands. And we never had any problems. So I opened the store in Walnut Creek.
And so you had two of them then?
I had two stores.
Two stores,
yeah. And I joined the Walnut Creek Chamber of Commerce, and so I got to know the merchants in Walnut Creek. And in fact, I told a lot of that, you know, to the Shadelands. And I was in on the, you know, the beginning of the Broadway Shopping Center. Mm-hmm. Edith Apgar, who was Graham McDonald's right-hand man, and I should say man more than woman, because she was a tough cookie. Mm-hmm. And she was the one, she got the options from the local people on the land that they wanted to put the center. So she very quietly went to each person and bought an option, you know, to buy the property from them. And once he had the package together, then they exercised all the options. And most of the people were very happy because it had been swampland there in the wintertime, and the rains came, you know, where the Broadway Shopping Center was, with swampy. So swamp grass going up. It's called the Botello. I think Botello Swamp or Botello property. And so she wanted me to come in there as a tenant. And I told her, she showed me a store. And I said, well, it's not big enough. By then, I'd built up my outside business, which was much bigger than the store business in Lafayette, and the one on Main Street, too. So I turned that down. And then about after the center opened, I think it opened in either 50 or 51, and she came up to my store, said, I want to show you something. So I went down with her, and she showed me a store. I don't know what had been in it, but it was a store with about a 30-foot front. And I said, Edith, I said, I need a lot more space than that. She said, well, I want to show you something. She took me to the back of the store, and there was a staircase in the back of the store. And we went down underneath, and underneath, there was this huge basement. was under that store and on another store next to it. And it was right next to the creek. The wall of the basement was, I guess you'd call it the culvert or the wall of the creek, the retaining wall of the creek. And Penny's was on the other side of the creek. Yeah. So I leased it. So I ran my outside business out of the basement. She didn't charge me for any more rent. At that time, they used to rent stores not by square feet, but by front feet, frontage. You know, they had 50 feet of frontage with so much a foot. Didn't make any difference whether the store was 10 feet deep or 100 feet deep. That's what they used to do it. So I didn't get charged for the basement. And so I ran a very nice business.
I wanted to ask you, Mr. Bru, when you first had your business in Lafayette, did you live in Lafayette at that time?
Yes.
Where were you?
About the first year, I lived in Berkeley on Durant Avenue, and I commute to Lafayette. It was like the opposite commute.
Did you drive or bus?
Oh, no, I drove.
You drove.
And Al Capanna and his wife, they lived in Berkeley, too, and they didn't have a car. So most mornings they'd drive with me. I'd open my store, they'd open their store on, on Moraga Road. And, honey, you want to get me a glass of water? I'm running out of steam.
Anybody else water or I'm coffee? Fine. Well, while he's getting his voice, I'll ask him a question or...
Do you want to take a break, maybe? I could do that and we'll...
I wanted to ask him at his store is where the China Wall... That used to be a grocery store, Patrick. Mm-hmm. That's probably what he was talking about. And then his store was on that corner, where there used to be some sort of a building, and they took that down. We used to remark about how small it was, and it just went right down into the creek there.
Oh, there was a little, like a pump house, you mean? So
whatever was there. I think that's where his property may have been.
Well, come again.
Okay. Your first store in Lafayette.
On Golden Gateway
was across the street from a grocery store?
Right.
Or was it Kitty Corner? Or just right across from it?
The grocery store, the building's still there. It's on First Street.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a Chinese
restaurant. That's right.
The Great Wall.
Yeah, well, that's the store.
That's...
I was right across the street.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it was a residential area.
That time?
Yeah.
There
was a theater, and there was a doctor's office, and there was Vince's, and my little 22-foot deal, and the rest of it was just empty. And I could stand in the front of my store, I'd look up the hill to Mount Diablo Boulevard, and I could see the back of the Veterans Building. The old Veterans Building.
Yes, that's where the new library is now.
And it was just fields. Oh, and there was a hill there when I first opened up.
Where Taco Bell is right now.
There was a hill where the Veterans Building was, east.
Yes.
There was a pretty good-sized hill. And there was what we used to call a steam shovel. And bit by bit, they dug away at the hill as builders needed, land or earth for various properties. They dig away at the hill. So over the years, the hill became flat.
Mount Diablo Boulevard did not go through at one time. Golden Gateway in the old days.
No, Golden Gateway was a through street. It started.
But it was the first street.
Yes, that was actually the original before they built the bypass. In 1936 was when they pushed through that to cut off Golden Gateway.
Right.
Golden Gateway was the original route of the Oakland Road.
Right. Well, I remember when they they finally passed a deal and started putting in the sewage. When I first got there, there weren't any sewage. You know, you had a septic tank. And when they started to dig on Golden Gate Way to put the sewer in, they were amazed at the thickness of the roadway. Simply because it had been the main highway.
They didn't realize that at the time, but as they say, it had been paved over and over, a lot of repairs in just a few years, because that was the main road.
Right.
Now, Patrick used to be a customer of your...
What?
Patrick used to be a customer of your...
Who?
Patrick.
I used to be a customer of Contra Costa Stationers.
Oh, in store.
Yes.
That was in a different location.
The new,
I was in three locations in Lafayette.
All right. Is this being recorded?
Yes.
All right. So you were in three locations, and the one that you remember was over by Bill's Pharmacy?
Yes.
That was the last location.
All right.
Yeah. The my first location, like I say, was on Golden Gate Way. And then Walnut Creek was very successful. And so I closed the Lafayette store. I owned the building, and I rented it to a gal for a knit shop for a while, and then I rented it to a guy that cleaned carpets. Eventually, I sold it. When I was looking to expand, I thought, you know what, Lafayette's growing, and there was a stationery store on Moraga Road. The guy, you get old, you forget names. I don't.
He's pretty good.
I don't remember the guy's name anymore. Oh,
it'll pop up.
Might have been Dick Mathis. I don't know. And he had a stationery store. Well, going back before that, when I first opened the one on Golden Gate Way, there was an old barn that was on the property on Moraga Road, just a little bit down from Mount Diablo Boulevard. And that's where the Lafayette Sun was printed, in that barn.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness.
I'm trying to remember the name of the family. Anyway, I know they sold the business to Herman Silverman. And he published the Lafayette Sun for quite some time. So I'm sure that he's in your history books. And then, of course, they built the building that are there now. And Lafayette was starting to grow. So
well, the store I remembered originally was at La Fiesta, the La Fiesta place.
Right. That was the second store.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember the name of the guy that I used to rent from. He was Italian, and he'd been a bootlegger during Prohibition. And he lived in a house on the north side of Mount Diablo Boulevard. You know where Safeway is now?
Mm-hmm.
Well, up the hill from that. He had a house that was painted purple so he could really see it. And like good Italians, he lived in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And he owned some property on Mount Diablo Boulevard. And you know where Petar's, not where Petar's used to be on Mount Diablo Boulevard, but where they moved down, was that Hoff Street?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. He built that building that Petar's was in.
Oh.
And
mm-hmm.
that building kind of goes back on what mm-hmm. you call La Fiesta mm-hmm. Square. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I named that street La Fiesta Square.
Did you?
It didn't have mm-hmm. a name. The post office didn't know where to deliver mail. So I said, well, we'll call it La Fiesta Square. And the postmaster said, okay.
Good for you. I'm glad we have that recorded.
So I
recorded.
Get my mail. There's some woman walking up here. Is there somebody else coming with
you? No, they're selling stuff. I'll just tell them.
Oh.
We're in a meeting.
I want to ask a couple of questions about your family. Find it interesting, if you don't mind. You seem to mention I have an uncle here and an uncle there and a cousin there. I was wondering about your brothers and sisters, if you have any.
I had an older brother.
All right.
We didn't get along.
Okay.
He stayed east. He lived in New York.
In New York.
Out on Long Island.
And you have just one daughter. Beautiful.
Same for years. Well, we have a son, John.
You have a son, John.
Yeah. In my first marriage, I had a son named David, and he lives up in Windsor.
All right. Yeah. Well, you've had quite an interesting life and business. He did so well. 26-year-old young man, no one guiding him particularly, and
right,
just your own brain trying to figure out.
I made so many mistakes, especially early on in the business. The opportunities that were here I didn't grasp, I didn't have a mentor.
Yes.
So I'd go in the bank. God, when I went in the bank, when I was going to open my store, and it was, we're going to put these buildings together, I had money. I had back pay from being in PW camp. I had the, back pay. So I had that money, and I had some money from my father's insurance. My dad died back in 1932. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't know anything about borrowing money from the bank or anything. And I started putting these two buildings together. Next thing I know, I'm running out of money. Mm-hmm. Outside of hawking my wife's jewelry, I couldn't figure out where the hell I'm going to get money. So I went down to the bank. It was called the Central Bank at that time.
In Lafayette.
In Lafayette, yeah. And I talked to the bank manager, and they wanted a loan. So we told him I had this property.
Collateral.
And the contractor's working on it, and I ran out of money. And he looked at me and said, I can't lend you money on that. I said, why not? Well, you don't have the property free and clear. I said, yes, I do. I paid for it. He said, yeah. I said, but there are people working on it, and there's possible liens on the property. No. I didn't know what the heck he was talking about. And he said, we can only loan money on property that's, unencumbered. Mm-hmm. So anyway, he took pity on me. And
you look like an honest person.
Loaned me the money to finish the building. And I remember it was a hot July day. And he came walking down Golden Gate Way from the bank. And he had a straw hat on. And he walked down. And here I was, we were in the midst of putting these buildings together and everything. And he stood there in the middle of the street and he looked at it. And I came out and on. And he said, is this what we loaned you money on? And I said, yeah. And he kind of shook his head. He turned around and walked back up the street. I knew that in his mind he'd written off that loan.
But you were a good, honest person.
And when I paid off the loan, he wrote me a letter, on the bank stationery, thanking me for paying off the loan and stuff.
And that started.
Yeah, he was a nice guy. His name was Walt Oakley. And he was the manager of the central bank. And that the bank at that time was in the Mayflower building, the space there. And there was a driveway there, and then right next to that, there was a huge old oak tree, and there was a restaurant, a tunnel inn.
Oh, yeah.
Was it oak tree or eucalyptus?
Could have been eucalyptus.
That's the famous eucalyptus.
Where the guitars? That's where the guitars.
It was a big tree. That's
where the guitars was originally.
And the tunnel inn was there. That's where Petard's eventually opened up. And then Don Thompson. Mm-hmm. He originally had a restaurant in Arinda, where the BART station is now.
Willows?
Yeah, is that called the Willows? At that time, the highway was a narrow highway. Yeah.
With the crossroads.
Was it the crossroads or the...
Was the name of the restaurant the Crossroads?
Crossroads. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Yeah, mm-hmm. He's good on that. Yeah.
Patrick is very good with history all over.
They had to move all those structures, either take them down or move them away, and then they widen the road.
And that was Don Thompson. I knew him very well. And so when they took that away from him, he came to Lafayette, and there was a restaurant called The Curve. Mm-hmm. And that's where he opened up the Cape Cod House.
Yes, you want to tell me what's happening now to what became Celia's? Now they're going to, demolish it?
Yes, well, tell you what, let me change the tape, because we're about at the end of...
You're kidding
me. Oh, no, just one half.
Mr. Bru, let's talk about changes in Lafayette. Things that you have noticed, the good and the bad.
Well, I don't get to Lafayette that much.
Well, what was good in the old days?
I go to Uncle Hughes.
Uncle Hughes, yes. What was good in the old days that you felt was just fine?
Well, probably the first big thing that happened in Lafayette was when they passed the bill to put in sewers. I can remember standing at the head of Moraga Road, where Safeway is now, blocking that area. That was a hill, and there was a hardware store at the top looking down on Moraga Road. And I remember the owner of the hardware store telling me if that bill didn't pass, that Lafayette would never be able to grow without a sewer system. Walnut Creek was going to, take over as a business area for Lafayette. So that was very important that sewer bill passed. Put in sewers that you could start to grow.
So you don't come to Lafayette any longer, certainly considering your age that you don't drive. Oh, wonderful! Oh, my gracious.
There was a...
good for you.
I told you about the hardware store right near it. Guy by the name of Pam Feely, and he opened up a little fish market, and they get the fish from Pittsburgh, from the river, and his wife's name was Barbara, and they eventually opened the Lafayette fish Seafood Grotto.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
That was their restaurant. They ran it for many
Very
years.
Very nice.
Good food. Good food.
Like the pots like they have at Fisherman's Wharf, the crab pots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So and you used to go to Pitar's restaurant.
You pointed with the Hamlin cleaners.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Bob, and Mr. Hamlin. Bob, did you know Oliver Hamlin?
Well, I knew Bob Hamlin. He was the guy that owned it.
Would that perhaps be his son? Mr. Hamlin just passed away about 2 months ago.
He'd been at least my age, yeah.
Yes.
Bob Hamlin, nice guy. And Lou Repetto, mm-hmm. he ran Lafayette Garbage, mm-hmm. a disposal company, I think. I knew him. And Kermie Blodgett, mm-hmm. Blodgett's linoleum, Blodgett flooring. I think his son's name was George Blodgett.
Well, you would know everyone in town. Oh, being yes. a businessman, of
and
course you would.
Norm Lescure, he was in a plumbing business, mm-hmm. and he had a place on Mount Diablo Boulevard, and he had a display. And the display was like toilets and toilet seats. I remember saying to him, "What do you got that kind of stuff in the window?" And he said, "Well, what do you want me to put in the window?" So,
did you belong to any organization such as Rotary or Lions or something?
No, they came after me. No.
They came after you.
Yeah, the American Legion came after me. Now, there were two guys in town when I got there. Well, there was a guy by the name of Colonel Smitten, and he's the guy that built that nice brick building in the middle of town.
Garrett.
Garrett. It was Colonel Smitten and it was Colonel Garrett. They were both veterans of World War I.
Oh.
And one of them, I don't know which one, built that. He wanted to make Lafayette like a little Carmel.
That's Colonel Garrett.
Why he built that.
Wanted all of the buildings to look like that. And it is beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know the one I'm speaking of.
That's the Postino restaurant there
right
now.
Right now.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And but the other two guys, well, Stanley, of course, he was a force in the town simply because he owned a lot of the property. But there was a guy by the name of Neil Cornwall. Was an insurance agent, and he was a veteran of World War I. Then there was a guy by the name of Pete Wilson at Wilson Plumbing. It was on Moraga Boulevard. He was a veteran of World War I. And they were the two strong guys in the American Legion. Mm-hmm. And they were the guys who wanted me to be in it. Well, coming from New York, I was radical, at least according to their thinking. And we were friendly, but politically, like that. So I wasn't about to join the American Legion. And it was the Kiwanis and the Rotary Club, you know, they'd always invite me to have lunch there and so on.
We were chamber.
My theory was, I kind of learned this from New York, if you belong to one of those clubs, then they're all your buddies, and if you're in business, you know, you're supposed to buy from your buddies, mm-hmm. whether their price is high or low, whatever, doesn't make them, they'll be your buddies. But because of that, then the ones that are in the other clubs, the Rotary, what, Kiwanis, the Elks Club, whatever, they're not going to buy from you because you're not in their club. So my theory was I don't belong to any of the clubs.
And they're all yours.
Yeah, so that way I never had that problem.
Yes.
Okay. But those were the two guys that they were pretty strong in town with the Legion. Okay. Now, does the word the appliance center, does that ring a bell?
I remember Lynx Appliance.
No. The appliance center, the building's still there. It's on the west end of town. It's a beautiful building. I think there's a Mexican restaurant in it. There was. But the appliance center, were two guys worked for Dow Chemical in Pittsburgh, and their sons were in the war. So they made up their minds that they would create a job for their sons when they came back from the war. So they built the appliance center. And when I came to town, it was just completed. And that was the nicest building in Lafayette. Mm. And it had the downstairs, a driveway for trucks underneath.
Mm-hmm.
And so the two sons opened it up as an appliance store.
Is it the big building that became, been restaurants through like Garcia's and
yeah.
The big one with the tile roof?
Yeah.
Yes, that's now Kelly Moore's Paints.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm. It's been had so many restaurateurs there, and now it's a paint store. It's a very nice building, but I didn't seem to be successful as a restaurant for some reason.
Well, these two guys, one was interested in having the business, the other one wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a guy by the name of Wiseman, and he was from Oakland. It had Wiseman's Appliances in Oakland, and he opened an appliance store. Is Diamond K Supply still there?
Very much so.
Okay.
Imagine that.
Well, in between Diamond K Supply and the Appliance Center was this building, Wiseman's Appliances.
Mm-hmm.
And he had a brother, Sam Wiseman, who had a children's shop in Lafayette, and another Wiseman, High Wiseman, who had a laundromat in Lafayette, right
on the
near,
corner.
You know where Trader Joe's is?
Yes.
Just
yes.
across the street
I used
from
to
Trader
use
Joe's.
That upon
yes.
occasion when mm-hmm. my
it's,
machine broke.
It's now a sushi restaurant.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. We liked it when it was the ice cream place.
Mm-hmm.
For a short time, it was Baskin-Robbins.
Yeah. Baskin-Robbins.
Wiseman's, the appliance store, had a big fire in the whole building. Burned out.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew Diamond K Supply, the guy that owned it, I can't remember his name anymore. He was in the war, and we knew each other. And there was a guy named Augie Kiesel. And he was kind of mysterious. I don't know whether he owned a part of Diamond K Supply. He was always there.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow or other, he was connected with gold mines in Alaska.
Mm-hmm.
I guess his family said they got their money. Mm-hmm. I remember him. Okay. Then on the other side of the street, you're talking like the Cape Cod House? Okay. Well, west from the Cape Cod House, all the property on that side was owned by the guy by the name of Bill Gordon, and he was commonly known as Gottrocks mm-hmm. Gordon.
Oh, mm-hmm. we saw an ad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, Gottrocks Gordon, he had been the purchasing manager for Firestone Stores
mm-hmm.
and retired. And during the war, his son was in the submarine division of the Navy.
Submarine Corps.
Yeah. And his submarine was lost at sea. And this was very, very distressing to his dad, to Gottrocks. And Gottrocks spent a lot of time, I think he traveled to Asia and looking for some sign, you know, of his son. So when I came along, like I said, I didn't know anything. And he kind of took me on, like a son. And most of people didn't like him. You know, he's kind of a rough, tough guy and argued with people. But he ran a good business. All the trucks, Lucas Trucking, you know, JT's brother, and all the other guys. At that time, this whole area was just booming. The realtors were there making money. The contractors were making money. The people that sold furniture and appliances into houses were making money. That's when Ed McGaw started building the houses in Pleasant Hill. You know, I remember driving out there on Gregory Lane, and they're building these houses, and they were going to be model houses for people to look at. And I remember going to the office, because that's what I do, you know, selling supplies. And I talked to the people in the office, and, well, you know, what's going on here? Well, we bought property, and we're going to build 100 homes here. And there was another guy, remember we used to go buy his place up at Tahoe. The hell was his name? I don't know. Herity, Phil Herity. Damn, I'm remembering. And he was going to build 100 homes next to where Ed McGaw is going to build 100 homes. And I said, out of my wisdom, you know, I said, you guys are crazy. I said, you're going to build who's going to buy the 100 homes? Well, before they finished the first model home, they had deals signed for every one of the 100 homes. They were buying more property, going to build more homes.
Yeah, that amazing.
That was Ed McGaw. He owned, what was the Oakland team? The A's? I think he owned the A's. And he'd been him and Phil Herity had both, during the war, they'd been carpenters in Vallejo. And I guess they made money there. And that they started Pleasant Hill. I mean, as far as building homes there.
Well, there was a lot of land out here to be developed. You know, all of those pear trees and walnut.
And you know where the freeway is as it goes by Pleasant Hill? Well, you know where the shopping center of Pleasant Hill, that area, and Contra Costa Boulevard, the freeway. Now, that used to be an airfield. It's called Sherman Field.
Yeah.
They were customer mine. And, yeah.
Did you know Bob Schroeder?
Hell yeah. I know Bob Schroeder. I knew Fran when she was going to high school.
Yes.
You know, and she's Stanley's daughter.
Yes.
And how well do you know her?
Well, I was in some musical shows on the stage with both of them and other people. I knew them pretty well. We danced.
Oh, they're wonderful people. But yeah. I have to tell you this, I shouldn't say it in front of my daughter, but when I had my first store there in Lafayette on Golden Gate Way, you know, no customers, so I spent quite a bit of time looking out the window. And Fran Schroeder at that time was going to school, I guess high school. And, you know, you've heard about Lana Turner and the Sweater Girls and so on.
You told me this before.
Oh, but I haven't heard that. So,
Fran was a sweater girl. You know. She's about 18. She'd come walking down. That was a bright spot of my day. And she'd wave and I'd wave. You know. Well, yeah.
She's still a very attractive woman, and you know, she's older than I.
She's a nice gal. And
yes, she is, darling. She it was very involved with the Shadlands Museum, and the proceeds of these shows that we were in on the stage benefited Shadlands. Well, So you saw her every day going home.
She was a real nice gal, and her mother was a nice woman, very well educated. But the father, M.H. Stanley, I have to say, I didn't, you know, he was probably the one guy in town I didn't like. And he didn't like me because I grabbed this 22-foot piece that he felt should have gone back to him.
One day
he came to me nicely. He came up to the store nicely. He wanted a route away from First Street over to the back of my property. I found out later he was bidding for the post office in Lafayette. He wanted on his property, but they needed a back way for the trucks. So I told him, no dice.
That didn't make
it. Didn't help. With Bob Schroeder, I knew his brother John and his dad, John Sr. It was this restaurant on Main Street that was right across where my store was. and I'd have lunch in there every day. A guy by the name of York had it. You know, what we used to call a one-arm restaurant, you know, with just a counter.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was
stools
or
something.
One table and chair in the back. And that was John Schroeder. Every lunch, he'd sit there and have lunch, you know, with somebody.
You know, Bob Schroeder's son is the mayor of Martinez.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Rob.
I think he is my brother's age.
Rob.
Yeah.
I think he and John were the same, around the same age. Oh, that's
it's a small world when you start talking to someone.
And then there was John Nedgley.
Oh, mm-hmm. John, yes. John Nedgley.
I knew him because he was a city attorney there in Walnut Creek.
And a senator.
He became a state senator.
Yes, and they named the bridge going over in the Delta there. Did you know Andrew Young, Andy Young, by any chance? Maybe not, because he was in...
Doesn't ring a bell.
More politics.
The Realtors in Lafayette, there was Snedeker, Marie Snedeker. She was a very well-respected Realtor. I remember her. She had blue eyes.
How about Petter?
Who?
Petter. Stan Petter and...
Jack.
Oh, Jack.
Jack Petter.
Jack Petter, I knew. Yeah. And his brother... One was in insurance, and the other was an attorney. They were the Petter boys. They were nice-looking boys. Yeah.
Well, I bet you know so many people that you can't even think of all of them.
Studebaker, A.L. Studebaker, Realty.
Mm-hmm.
He was a good realtor. Yeah, I know. I was talking about Gottrock Sport.
Isn't that some name?
Yeah.
He was also famous for his ads, which were a little
risque.
Yes.
Did you know that?
His ads were risque.
His ads in the Sun. Yes.
We have copies of the Sun at the Historical Society. It would be nice if you could come up and see us sometime, Mae West.
Bring my dad.
Yes. Yeah. We will tell you where it is. It's downstairs, right across the street almost. It's on Gateway, and there's a bookstore on the corner, but it's part of the library, and the history room is next door to that. And Patrick and I are there on Tuesday mornings from 10 until noon, and we can show you all of the things that we have and might bring back some other memories of yours.
Yeah.
Are we still?
Yes, we're still.
Mm-hmm. Really,
you say you have copies of the Lafayette Sun.
Yes, we do, and we get.
How about the Contra Costa?
Don't want to.
Lucas Plumbing. Does that ring a bell?
Oh yes, he did Lucas. Our driveway. The young man.
Lucas Paving.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they've been
That's
in
the
for
same family.
That same family for a couple or three generations, I believe. That right, Lucas? Yeah, nice looking.
It was originally Lucas and Genesee.
Was it?
They were a partnership.
Well, thank you. Which may not even know that.
Genesee moved, I think, down to Fresno or someplace.
Well, it's a lucrative business still going on.
Now, El Charro, are you familiar with that?
That's the fact about the oldest business still running under its original name in Lafayette.
Well, Frank and I opened just about the same time.
Okay.
He had just a little wooden building. I remember going in and eating at a table, and you could peek through the wall, you know, and see the daylight outside.
It's very popular now, especially.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
Yeah, they dance there sometimes, don't they?
I know the current owners.
Beg your pardon?
I know the current owners.
Oh, do you?
El Charro.
Do you go there?
Yeah, my daughter worked there for a while, and then I went to school with Laura Shields, who's... her husband owns it.
All right. Very good.
Love El Charro. I remember going there as a kid, and we'd eat that dip. You know, they still had that dip. But my brother and I would get hamburgers instead of tacos, and my dad would always say, someday you'll grow up and, you know, eat something other than a hamburger when we go out to dinner. And now, you know, I love their food.
Tell me, Bob, I remembered, of course, the place at La Fiesta. What was behind the decision to move from La Fiesta to the place on Mount Diablo Boulevard near the new post office?
Well,
larger facility?
It was particularly larger, but I had no foot traffic.
Oh, I was
at the one on La Fiesta Square at all.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember whether I closed that store, and then it was a time before I opened the one next to the post office.
But it was a good decision, I'm sure.
Yeah. Well, whatever.
Because you became a very good businessman.
It was a good store for us, the one in Lafayette.
Yes.
The landlord was a nice guy. That building was financed by Alexander and Baldwin, which is a big outfit in Honolulu.
Mm-hmm.
And
I remember so much.
It's one of the fairest landlords I had. You know, mm-hmm. And then Steve Parks. That's another realtor. He was in the building. You're talking about the one that Colonel Garrett built.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the office building west, you know, directly mm-hmm. west of it, mm-hmm. across the driveway. That was originally owned by Garibaldi. And then the Parks realtor from Oakland bought it. And Steve Parks, he was his son.
I remember that.
And he rented me my building in Walnut Creek on North Broadway, mm-hmm. next to the post office.
Mm-hmm.
You've supplied us with so much history of Lafayette that I'm sure we don't even realize, you know, because no one's been talking about
all this. See, now, you haven't talked
this.
About the stretch, let's say, from Hamlin's east.
Let's talk Lafayette. About it, then. Mm-hmm.
The
Tell
same
us.
Guy in the hardware store that I told you about, that sewers,
mm-hmm.
and when he was talking about Lafayette, he says Lafayette's built like a cattle trail. A cattle comes down and drops a little here, drops a little there. And that's how it was,
mm-hmm.
all the way down to where the Lafayette Park Hotel is now.
Mm-hmm.
That whole strip, you know, very nondescript.
Cattle drive. There's a picture of the cattle drive.
There was no real plan. It was just here, there,
right.
and straggling.
Yeah, but there were a lot of businesses there. There was, of course, El Charro. And now, we haven't talked about Don Blackwood. That ring a bell?
Or Don Black.
It should be.
I know.
Don Black or Don Blackwood?
Well, Blackwood is I know there's Blackwood Place.
Wasn't Don Black a mayor?
He had a contract with the county for the school buses.
Mm-hmm.
All the school buses were Blackwood Transportation. And he had the automobile dealership in Lafayette, the only one, you know, what they had, Dodge, Conti.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Conti Dodge.
Buick.
Yeah.
Or
no, Buick. It wasn't Buick.
It was Dodge.
Conti.
Yeah. Well, Don Blackwood owned that. And he was from Texas. And moneyed guy, real, another smart guy. And he had the buses, and then he had the automobile dealership there, and of course, he repaired all the buses in his place. And I remember one day I was in there, it was a good customer of mine, calling on him, and he says, "How's your business doing?" I says, "Oh, fine." He says, "Well," says, "you making any money?" I says, yeah, I'll make money. And so anyway, he drew out of me the fact that what I thought of making money was working in the business and being paid my salary, you know, and living. And he said, "Well, that you're not making any money." He said, "Supposing you didn't work there and you had to hire somebody to run the business and pay them, said, would you have any money left over?"
Hmm.
I thought about that, you know. I said, "Well, not very much." He says, "Well," he says, He says, you're not making any money. You're just making a living. And that stuck with me.
Goodness, I think you did very well. Very.
But he was a very respected guy.
Did you know Don Young that had the Ford agency? Don Young.
Yeah, Don Young. I think he had a car from there. Don Young Ford. You bought a car from him. I remember that name.
He came down into Lafayette. Walnut Creek later on. Yeah.
I remember him in Walnut Creek. Don Young Ford.
Don Young?
Don and his wife was Gail.
There's only one Ford agency in Walnut Creek.
What was it called?
I don't know what it's called now.
Stead.
No, but where did you used to buy your cars from? In Walnut Creek.
Or Lafayette.
Yeah, it was a Ford place.
Mm-hmm. Cadillac.
No, you bought the station wagon down. Oh, Parker Robb.
Okay.
Yeah, but I remember Conti, that name.
That was originally Reinhold. Reinhold Chevrolet, where Parker Robb was. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, they were the guy, wasn't friendly. His bookkeeper was. She liked me, you know. And so when cars became available after the war, I bought this Chevrolet, what do we call it? Oh, it's a panel, like a panel truck.
Mm-hmm.
And very grudgingly, he gave me his business because I bought the car. And he was friendly with a stationer from Richmond or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Yeah, I knew all the automobile dealers. It's J.T. Lucas, that was Studebaker in Walnut Creek. He was a tough guy, boy, I'll tell you. And his brother, Tony, he had the Dodge dealership next door. And then two guys, Mayus and Simmons, came into Walnut Creek and they opened up the first Volkswagen dealership.
Now there's an automobile row in Walnut Creek, just like in San Francisco on Van Ness Avenue.
Lafayette only had this one automobile dealership. There was a Kaiser. When they built the Kaiser automobile right after the war, there was a Kaiser dealership at the intersection of Mount Diablo Boulevard and Pleasant Hill.
Down there.
You know, go by Accolani's High School, that road. At the intersection of Mount Diablo Boulevard, there was a Kaiser automobile agency there. But getting back to this nondescript strip in Lafayette, it was Western Newell was the family that owned it. Western Western Sand and Gravel. They were good friends and customers. And then there was the Shell Oil. It's still there. That was Mel Nielsen. And his partner.
Talking about the station that's been.
Mel Nielsen became the head of the Board of Supervisors.
Nielsen.
Martinez. He lives up above me in Lafayette when I was living there. He was a nice guy. And who else was there? Oh, Gillette's. Did that ring a bell?
The Gillette building?
Gillette's Furniture.
Yes, with a J.
Right, J-E-L-L-E-T. Mm-hmm. He was a hell of a nice guy, and he built that building and had good furniture in it.
Mm-hmm.
He's way ahead of his time in Lafayette. And don't remember what other businesses were down on that strip.
Did you ever
go? Oh, there was a lumber yard where the Lafayette Park Hotel is now.
Sun Valley Lumber.
Yeah, Sun Valley Lumber. Mm-hmm. Now, they were the guy I never could sell. The people who worked there were friendly and they'd come in the store and buy, but the owner never would sell. I'm Jewish, and I was the only example that I know of where I think I was dealing with an anti-Semite that he wouldn't buy from me because I was Jewish. Mm. It's not proven, but
you had that feeling.
That's about the only thing that I ran into. Where I ran into more than anything else was my liberal feelings, because I was there during the McCarthy era, E-R-A. And the whole town of Lafayette was behind Joe McCarthy and his fight against communism. I was probably the only one in Lafayette that hated his guts. And I remember Neil Cornwall in particular, the one that I said was in the American Legion, telling me, you know, as a friend, he said, don't open, ever open your mouth about McCarthy, because you lose all your business sometimes. That's how strongly that era was.
What about when you were prisoner of war, then in Germany?
What about?
Did they...
Because he was Jewish?
Single you out
in Germany?
Single me out?
Yeah,
oh, because I'm Jewish?
Yeah, no. Really?
He's an officer, though. That wasn't that a big deal?
Well, no, the Germans... were covered,
it's American.
You know, with the Geneva Convention. They kept to the Geneva Convention. I'd have to say for the most part. they did as far as American and British flying officers.
You were a pilot, did you say?
We were prisoners of the Luftwaffe.
Navigator.
You were the navigator.
Yeah. We were prisoners of the Luftwaffe, which was Hermann Göring's outfit, you know, at the Air Force.
And were you shot?
And they were much better people, let's put it that way, than the Wehrmacht. If you're a prisoner of the Wehrmacht, which was the German army, and wasn't very good.
Was your plane shot down?
Yeah.
Is that it? And you?
My 15th mission, I was shot down. Yeah. See, I flew early in the war. We had no fighter planes protecting us. You know, just strictly the B-17s against the Focke-Wulfs and the Messerschmitts.
43 was really the rough time when
it was a bad
they didn't have the control of the skies.
Oh, no. No, we only had about, if I said 100 B-17s, in actual ability to fly, was probably more about maybe 60.
Well, you've had such a full and interesting life, Mr. Bru.
Well, if I can ask maybe two questions, what is the part you liked most about living in working in Lafayette, and what is the part you maybe wish could have been improved?
At that time?
When you were working in Lafayette.
I really can't think of anything that could be improved. I like Lafayette. I like the people there. I found it's a group, and still, all the time we had the store there, the people are, they're educated people. You know, I always felt they were good people as compared to the customers I had in Concord, a store in Concord, or at a store in Danville.
Is that right? Well, that's nice.
And I think the Lafayette people like shopping Lafayette.
See, Rinda, to me, Rinda, I never had a store there. I had a lot of customers, but no store. Rinda, it's too much phony, you know, trying to live up to the Joneses kind of thing.
Oh, that's supposed to be the friendliest town in what, the nation?
Yeah, well, the second friendliest town of its size, only a place in up there, Seattle, is supposed to be friendlier.
We wonder why.
He's talking maybe way back when. I don't know.
Yeah. They've learned.
Yeah.
They've evolved. Well...
He had a binder pop. Do you
want
to show him your binder?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You might want to get that on tape, I don't know.
Oh, this is not a gift. This is a trade.
Let's see. You have to trade.
What time is it?
Well, we have about another 5 or 6 minutes.
That's all you have left.
I think so.
But we can talk about this.
Well,
yes.
Like I say, this I'm trading because I want a copy of that book on Lafayette.
Oh,
I'm perfectly willing to pay for it, but I want it. Okay, this is a book that I used when I'd go out and selling printing. Now, there was a guy by the name of Len Bonington who lived on Moraga Boulevard, and he was a printer, a master printer.
Mm-hmm.
And so these are samples, like his Beavis Animal Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
And
some of the businesses that used to be. There's the Luca Community Methodist Church.
All different cuts, King Trucking.
Mm-hmm. Did you know the Methodist Church used to be one of the schools? It was
the schoolhouse.
Mm-hmm. It was the second, was
or the third.
Oh, down on that little, third? That little street?
No, well, across the street from the old library.
It has a steeple.
Yeah, I kind of remember it.
Mm-hmm. It used to be a schoolhouse. The Arinda Beauty Shop. The clubhouse.
Now, the Arinda Beauty Shop, those two guys, they were in Arinda, and then they moved to Walnut Creek. And,
let me look over here, a letter.
They were both gay, and I remember there was a big scandal in Walnut Creek, and one of them was caught in the park, in the restroom, But, didn't hurt them. All the women went there. Believe me. Yeah. But I thought you'd be interested in
this. This is your scrapbook, absolutely. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. And the Adobe.
I knew him, though. I knew the people that ran the restaurant and then the guy that owned the El Nido Ranch. So that's another group I'll tell you about.
And Orchard Nursery.
Up
near where we live. Mm-hmm.
Jack Schneider and Stu Wade. They were the guys that
had the
Orchard Nursery.
Yeah.
And Stu Wade got disinterested in it. He moved to Hawaii. But Jack Schneider ran the Orchard Nursery for years.
Mm-hmm.
He lived down where Akilani's High School is. He lived down that area. Nice guy. And
this is over near where the guy was.
In Lafayette, right at the corner where the Park Theater is, mm-hmm. and there's a little park in front of it,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I think it's a gas station, a Union
yes.
gas
yes.
station.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Well, that used to be a restaurant there.
We have mm-hmm. pictures, yeah, don't we?
Yes, mm-hmm. King's or a long time ago.
I don't, well.
But it
now it's tile became,
roof. He moved.
Tile roof and.
He was terribly beaten up one day with a robbery. Never really recovered from it. Just a real nice older guy.
Mm-hmm.
And he moved from there to Concord, mm-hmm. where the adobe building is. You know, it's a relic there in Concord. Mm-hmm. He had a restaurant there.
Oh, Salvio Pacheco's?
Was that the adobe animal health center?
Salvio.
Salvio
just off of the main street there.
Yeah. Mm.
First owner over there before it became Concord.
There were three guys. They were all about the same age, all big and handsome. One of them was Bob, and I can't remember his last name, and he owned the El Nido Rancho Hotel. Okay. Another one was Bob Jers, and he was, I think he was like a food broker.
Mm-hmm.
And another tall, handsome guy. And then there was a third. It was three Bobs. Bob Rector. And Bob Rector owned the Cadillac agency in Walnut Creek. And he eventually sold it to Bob Jers. It became Jers Motors in Walnut Creek. And Rector moved down the peninsula. And, Rector Motors down the peninsula. It's a pretty established automobile dealership. But all three of them were friends. And
mm-hmm.
they
That was there as the Lafayette Inn until 1968 or so. Because I remembered looking at it from Vallecito's, since I was at Vallecito's school, and you could go to the fence at the end of the field.
Well, El Nido Rancho was right across the street from Orchard Nursery.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Or, and they took it out for the freeway.
Yes, when they widened the freeway for BART, they took that out.
It was a pretty place there, wasn't it? Mm-hmm.
They used to have that strip from the hill, St. Charles Hill.
Charles Hill. Mm-hmm.
Hill. Mm-hmm. A nice straightaway right down past Orchard Nursery and El Nido Rancho into Lafayette. There would be terrible, terrible accidents on that strip. Of course, it was a three-lane highway. With the lane in the middle, you know, for turning, passing.
Yes.
Oh, God, head-on collision.
We see them in the sun with the newspaper.
All the time.
Pictures and everything.
Before the freeway was built, every week they'd be
terrible ones. I mean, really smashed to nothing. Well, these are just really precious things.
Now, this is my store. 1948. Every year, I'd mail out these cards.
The Christmas cards to your
people.
Customers.
And they'd come in and order their Christmas cards.
Good,
do big business with Christmas cards. He is the bookworm.
Mm-hmm.
And that was drawn by my cousin in New York.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. The Mount Diablo Therapy Center, that was a big thing. A lot of chapters. I'm sure there was a chapter in Lafayette.
Mm-hmm. Those are wonderful.
And she rented for me for a while, Emily's Needlecraft.
And it's Gillette's furniture. Not even be aware of. And why do we have the...
I'll get back to that in a minute. So that's the client center.
Yes, that's the big building.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yeah. These are all, customer. Jim Sherry, does that ring a bell? He's another guy. He was in the war, and his dad decided to set up a business for him when he came home.
Mm-hmm.
And he opened up Sherry's men's clothing shop.
Mm-hmm.
And his son... was running it, and he had no interest in it. I'd go in that store, and here he was trying on a new suit, for himself, looking in the mirror and everything. So the moral of that story is, don't ever try to set up a business for one of your kids. It'll never work. But now, family, my son, when I decided I didn't want to be in business anymore.
Yes.
And I offered him, at that time, the two things that made money first was the Lafayette store and the outside business.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd close the one at Broadway Plaza and so on. And I offered him the business. He didn't want it. Didn't want the responsibility of running a business.
Mm-hmm.
So he's happy. I mean,
what does he do now?
He sells office supplies. out of San Francisco.
All right. Mm-hmm. He's doing what he wants to do.
But he doesn't.
He didn't want the responsibility.
Yeah.
It's a lot to take on.
Very brave. You have to be very brave to be a business person.
I can remember years ago reading something about that owners, business people in for themselves, they'd come home, to have dinner. And they'd sit there and they'd complain about all the problems they had that day.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And the kids would sit there and they'd listen to that.
Mm-hmm.
See? So the picture that they'd get of somebody being in business for themselves was not a happy one.
Negative.
Mm-hmm. They didn't want it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, my dad owned a repo agency, and that was certainly a lot of interesting problems involved with that.
Yeah. Scary.
Yes.
Exciting, though.